My name is Jin Stearns. My Korean name actually is Kim Jin-soo. And came here in 1973 through an adoption, and I was 10 years old. I was lost and separated from my family, and then they were searching for me as much as I was, you know, searching for them as well. It all happened at the train station in Seoul back in 1968. And currently I live in Canton, Ohio, and I'm 51 years old, and I have a wonderful, wonderful family, a wife and a son and a daughter. And son actually is 28, lives in South Carolina, and the daughter is 10 and thinks that she's 26. So I have to fight that every day, so, and here I am today.
John Ripka, I live in Washington, D.C. I'm 33 years old, and I was adopted when I was 7, and I grew up in East Tennessee.
My name is Paul Howe, and I am 46 years old. I was adopted from Korea, a little city outside of Seoul called Ilsan. And it's a little, what they call a satellite city, because it's really an extension of Seoul. And I was 9 years old when I was adopted from Ilsan. And I am currently from New York City.
Hi, my name is Judy Hudek. I'm getting back into the workforce.
My name's Bill. I work for Tropicana Manufacturing Management.
We adopted Emily when she was 6 months old and Jack when he was 10 months old.
My name is Jack. I'm 12 years old. I'm in 7th grade and I was adopted as 10 months old.
My name is Emily. I'm 9 years old. I'm in 4th grade and I was adopted when I was 6 months old.
It was probably when my parents started telling me like what adoption meant a while ago, and I knew I was adopted for a while before that. I just never knew what it meant. But then I, when they told me, it kind of clicked how I looked different from them.
Well, I'd always known from that I came from a different family, but I never really realized why. And I think so once I started to learn more about it, I kind of got more upset about it. I'd always ask my parents questions and stuff, like why, or why didn't they want me? A lot of times it was just why.
I have a lot of memories from Korea, actually. I can remember even being on my mother's back. My mother would wrap like a cloth around her body to support me against her back. And I remember it was raining, and the raindrops would splash up to my feet and tickle my feet. I had this thought, like recently, she must have been pretty short, actually, because the raindrops didn't have far to go.
My brothers and I have two older brothers, and we were basically searching for our parents because they were separated and they were, you know, in their different directions. And my oldest brother, at that point, he would have been around 13 years old, and he decided to make that his focus. Basically, we traveled from Busan, South Korea, towards Seoul, because that's where he found out that they, you know, went their separate ways. My brother went to Seoul train station to work because he shined shoes. One day I followed him to work, and I think he asked me a simple question like, do I know how to get back? And of course I told him yes. Back in 68, the train station is really, really crowded. So in about a couple minutes, and then I got separated from him, and he never, you know, I didn't see him, he didn't see me. And then that couple minutes become a couple hours. Then it became, you know, 4, 5, 6 hours, and then I hid underneath a bench for him to come back, and he never did. And then the day turned into next day. Then it became a week or two, and then the police found me at the train station, basically, and then took me over to my first orphanage, and then from then I lived through there for about a year and a half, 2 years in that first orphanage. And then from then that orphanage closed, and they took a lot of those kids from that orphanage to Holt.
The memories I have from Korea is a little tough because the comparison I always make is that my friends, when they're growing up, a lot of times they have adult people or pictures or videos to kind of corroborate their memories or to build memories for them. I was adopted when I was 7, and I thought I had all these memories, and I never had any sort of reinforcement whether these memories are true or not.
What I remember, I was born in Ansan, which is a suburb of Seoul, and I grew up with my father, my biological father, my biological mother, and my sister was born about 2 years after me. When I was three, our house burned down, and I still have these scars on my body from that. And I think that put additional stress on my parents' marriage. And so I moved down to a village around Gwangju to live with my father's parents. When I was five, my grandfather passed away. And so my father came back, took me back to go back up to Seoul, and my sister stayed down with my grandmother.
I remember this as the place I used to live. There's the main road up two, three roads, like I said. This is where it used to open up. There was a cab driver that lived here. We would play soccer in this open courtyard. This is where our house used to be. There used to be gates up about 8-10 feet high. It was like an open courtyard. As little kids, we talked about all these tall buildings. What were not here, at least to this extent. And this house right here, there used to be someone very, very rich lived in this house because they had an indoor flushing toilet and a bed. I remember that. We fantasize about living in that house.
My father was in the military, so I would see him, you know, from the mind of a child, it felt like a couple of weeks, once every couple of weeks, would stop by and bring gifts, you know, toys for me to play with and say hello to my mom. And so it was just essentially me and my mother. So when she would go to work in the morning, I would often wake up with a sense of abandonment. I would cry. And you know how the Korean doors are made, like the wood and then the paper over the traditional going from side to side. And I would rip the paper. I would rip the paper and then I would scream through the paper. You know, I would just cry and scream. And I remember the neighbors would hear me, so they would come and get me out. And just because I was, I don't know why she would want to like lock me in the room, but maybe she just wanted to keep me safe for a few hours until she got back. You know, I didn't go to school because it was trouble for me. You know, when my hair grows out, it's actually an afro. So, in Korea, especially at the time, if you're mixed with anything, like if you're even part Japanese or part Chinese, it was a big deal. You know, everybody made a big stink of it. And so if you're part black, it's like, oh my God, there's no place where you can run to. You can't even pretend, you know? There was this word, and I still haven't gotten it straight. In my child's mind's understanding of the word, it was gamur. Gamur is Korean. I thought it meant black, gamur. And I actually studied Korean for a little while with this woman, and she said that there's a word actually in Korean that's gemur. And gemur actually means monster. And so they were actually calling me monster. I thought it was meant black, but I'm a black monster.
What I remember the most about the orphanage life, especially the first one, it was really, really different. You know, I was six and a half, seven years old at this point, and my first job, you know, with the first orphanage, actually was to make breakfast for kids. Yeah, I made a lot of mistakes the first, you know, couple times. I burned the rice and I spilled the water all over, you know, the floor and got the, you know, fire out and from the big black kettle that we used. But you know, I really missed my family when I was in my first orphanage. Because I really didn't know what to do at this point. I didn't like the orphanage because it was pretty rough. Was I thinking about my brother all the time? Absolutely. I was wondering if they're gonna come, you know, look for me. So I always had that in mind as well. So I ran away a couple times from the orphanage, and I didn't get too far. Get caught and, you know, send it right back to the same orphanage. And I think I did that probably about 3-4 times. I guess the lesson, you know, learned from that is I never learned a lesson because I kept running away, and even though I get beat up again and I get scolded at, but I just thought always that that my brother was looking for me or somebody was looking for me, and I kept that hope alive, and I kept wondering like someday they're gonna come find me.
I started running away from home to find my mother, and it would start just a few hours at a time, and then it would go for a day at a time, and then it would go for days at a time, and I think it's fair to say that my father didn't know how to deal with that, and I don't think that that was, I think it exasperated maybe some of the issues that he had in his life, and the way that he expressed his frustration was essentially like beating the crap out of me. I distinctly remember a time when I ran away for a day and he hogtied me, and then he took this brush about this long and like would beat the bottoms of my feet so they would bleed so I couldn't walk anymore, and like hogtie me and leave me in the corner for like a days at a time. So obviously that didn't have the intended effect, and I ran away even more and more, and to the point where I just didn't come back. And that's when I got picked up off the street to put up for adoption.
When a hope took me in at a, I think I was like 8 and a half, good food, clothes, great place to live, great family, great environment, excellent, they took care of you when it comes to health-wise. So I just thought that the Holt was it. I mean, it was just beautiful. I had everything. Only thing I didn't have is my parents and my family. And that was still, I was kind of wishing for that.
At the time when I was living on the streets in Korea, it was in the 1987, and quite honestly, there was a lot of poverty still in Korea, right? Like, Korea like prides itself on being one of the fastest developed countries in the world, but at the time, there was a lot of poverty, and I distinctly remember a lot of elderly and young people just living on the streets of Seoul. When you're a kid, you don't want to be by yourself on the street, right? Like, you want to try to get into a gang or a group of other kids. There's some degree of safety in the numbers, but sometimes you split off to find food or to mess around or whatever. I distinctly remember when things got really, really bad when I was living on the streets. One night it was really, really cold and I broke into this house. And my house is a stretch, right? One room, one kitchen, and that's it. And I broke in and they had this huge, like bigger than me at the time, probably, urn, is that the right word? Jar? Whatever, of kimchi. And I ate a lot of that, and I accidentally fell asleep because it was warm inside. And when I woke up, there was this lady there. Obviously, she lived there, and I thought she was gonna be totally pissed at me, as she should. But instead, she took a lot of care for me. And the way that I remember it, I remember anytime things got bad, I know that I could always go to her. I have two memories of her besides that. And they're always at night. For some reason, I think she's Catholic. When I distinctly remember us sitting in a room in a circle with all the other women, and I felt like they were doing some sort of worship or prayer group or whatever. And I distinctly remember like laying my head on her lap and falling asleep to her, like brushing my hair. The other memory I have of her is a lot of times we would go walks at night, and I would walk next to her and I would hear the change in her pocket walking next to her. I would hear that change in my ear. And then she would go to a noodle stand and buy as many bowls as she could, and she would hand it out to the elderly folks who were begging on the street. That was everywhere when I was young. Like these old folks who didn't have children to take care of them, who were, bent down in shame and just like, held their hands like this. She would go to each one of them and put a bowl of noodles in their hands until she ran out of money. And one time I went into a building to just get warm or whatnot, and there was this guy playing a guitar. And so I was just listening to him, and then afterwards he came up and spoke to me because there wasn't that many people in the building. And he was rehearsing, it was a church, he was just rehearsing, and his mom was a foster parent that took care of adoptee children until they're adopted. Usually they're babies, and usually they, they're for like 2 or 3 weeks, and then, they're often adopted. So he took me to her, and she took me to the adoption agency, and I think, if the story is right, the adoption agency said, no, he's too old, he's not going to get adopted. And she's like, fine, I will take care of him as long as you put him up for adoption. So I stayed with her and her family, that family, for about 6 or 7 months, And then that's when I was adopted. So I never had the orphanage experience.
I guess my mother was somewhat ostracized from her family because I didn't really see much of her family, just this one aunt who would stop by a lot. Very close to us, she would visit like quite often, and she loved me, you know. When I was 5 years old, an argument between my mother and somebody I saw around a lot, and an argument between them was escalating about money. I have to sometimes question like how much of what I remember is what really happened, what happened, and what is the imagination of a child. I remember my mother had really long hair, and this woman was actually quite, she was large, she was much bigger than she was. But she grabbed her hair and just smashed her into cement. And so moments pass and somebody calls something that is equivalent to an ambulance. The ambulance comes and they take my mother, and I remember as this ambulance was driving away, it's like this dramatic moment, you know, because it's a dirt road and it's dry and it's going off and it's just kicking up all this dirt. But through it, I can see the back of the window, my mother's head like leaning over to one side. And then I'm in a hospital and there's a white sheet over her and adults are talking their adult talk. And I guess people try to explain to me what like death was. And I was too young to understand what it was. So I remember two events after her death, and one was her funeral. She was placed in this room that's a few feet above ground with her picture on the coffin. And there were these Korean women dressed in traditional garb. And they would all kneel and sit on this dirt floor. And they would just cry, just as a group, just sit there and cry. And they would pound the dirt floor. Next thing I know, I'm with my father. He came to get me, and we're on a train going somewhere, and we're with this woman, and he's talking to this woman. And next thing I know, I'm living with this woman. So I live with this woman for a year and a half, 2 years. And she was quite abusive. I got a lot of beatings. Like it was every other day, like I did something wrong to be beaten. And she was brutal. One night, I can't remember what I did wrong, but I did something wrong, and she says to me, I want you to go home, and on your way home, I want you to collect a bundle of sticks that I'm gonna beat you with. And I think about it now, and it's like, I have to laugh, because it's like, what am I gonna think? Like, pick up a stick and go, yeah, this should be sufficient. This will give me a good beating, you know? So one day after the 2 year period, she says to me, you're going to America. And I had no idea where America was. I didn't even know where I was at that moment. I moved around so many times. Either I said it to her aloud or in my head, I said, okay. And part of it is because it's gotta be better than here. Whatever it is. And I remember my aunt who, she's the aunt who loved me. And she was there on my last day. And then the surprise was, it wasn't America I was going to, I was going to an orphanage.
When I first got the note that I'd been adopted, you know, if you can imagine winning a lottery ticket, you get, your name get pulled. And I feel like that's the excitement that I, you know, at that point. It's almost like that, you know, the movie that the Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory, where, you know, you got the golden ticket, going walking around and showing everybody, you know, flashing the ticket. I was doing that the same thing with my letter, you know, showing everybody. And it was a happy moment, but it was kind of sad because I've seen other kids there that should be adopted as well. A couple of kids I grew up with at the same age, with 9 and 10 years old, and I feel very sad because even though I was very joyful and excited, but I wish that they can, you know, come with me. They actually send you a picture of my parents. They're absolutely beautiful pictures. You know, the funny thing was too, they asked me what my favorite color was on the letter, but I wasn't sure why they even asked me what my favorite color was at that point, because I thought, wait a second, you know, what's the color got to do with anything with the adoption? But I just got excited at that point, so I told them yellow, and then I found out that I really don't like yellow. They asked me about my favorite food, and of course I put down rice and kimchi, because that's all we had. Of course, you know, they had no idea what kimchi was.
One of the things I want to say about those pictures was that I hated my pictures. I hated the pictures that they gave me. And because I looked at the other kids' pictures, I'm like, oh my God, your house is so much more beautiful. Your sister is so much more beautiful. Like everything about it was just so much better. Like, you know, I looked at mine, I was like, oh my God, what is this? There was a kid who was black. There was a kid who was white. There was a kid who was like brown, like all these different things. And I was like, what is that? I mean, it didn't make any sense to me. Because for me, like for me, an American family was like this white, you know, like the typical whatever you envision, you know, white. Everything had to be white. And I wanted to be white. I want to become white. I want to be a part of this whiteness.
We were trying to get pregnant for a long time and it was not going very well. And we went to Resolve, a conference in the San Francisco area. Talks about, you know, coming to terms with your infertility. And people talked about adoption, and it just really resonated, I think, with both of us. Versus continuing our going through fertility treatments, we decided that adoption was the path for us. Once we submitted our application to Korea and our photos, how long did that take? About 6 months to get matched?
From the time we submitted the application until Jack came home, it was a little over 10 months.
I remember that day like it was yesterday. I remember getting the FedEx envelope, and I remember I didn't think it was my son, and I was like, this is a picture of our son. And I remember Bill turning to me and saying, yes, that is your son. And it was real clear for me. It didn't matter what his picture was, or I don't know. I just remember it very vividly, that, like, come on, shake out of it, Judy. Yes, this is your son, and get excited. So it just seemed unreal or something until you said, that's your son.
I mean, it was incredibly exciting from when, you know, Judy called me and said, hey, they called. You know, you've got to literally drop everything you're doing and get on a plane and fly over there if you're going to travel there. You got to be there within, I think it was within 4 or 5 days.
Yeah.
You know, you dream about being a parent, and then, you know, you finally realize, my God, it's actually going to happen.
I remember we were at the Fresno airport. We had to connect in San Francisco. And I just remember crying and turning to Bill and saying, all I wanted to do for the last 5 months was get on the plane. And finally, we're getting on the plane.
I don't remember when I was told I was adopted, but I had known for a while now. Because sometimes my friends ask me, like, were you adopted? And I say yes, because I don't look like my parents.
Met Jack on our first day there with his foster mother, and you could tell they had an inseparable bond. I mean, she was great. She shared everything with us, but he was latched onto her. I mean, I think that's what we both remember most from that initial meeting. And then we had like 2 or 3 days after that before we could bring him home. I will never forget when we picked him up from the adoption agency. They took Jack from his foster mother, who was crying, you know, we were all crying, and we got in a van, and Jack was screaming at the top of his lungs, clawing at the windows in the van to get out and get back to his foster mother. I will never forget that as long as I live. It was the longest 10 or 15 minutes of my life. And then he cried uncontrollably the whole way to the airport. And when we got to the airport, he kind of went catatonic.
Oh, that's right.
And we got on the plane, and he didn't really sleep on the plane a little bit. He just latched onto me, and for 12 hours, I walked up and down the aisles of that airplane holding him. And all the Korean mothers and grandmothers on the plane were trying to help me as I'm walking up and down the aisles.
And I think I cried every day for 1 month because I didn't, watching that loss was really difficult for me.
Yeah. He, I think it took him about a month to adjust until it felt like he was ours and he knew we were his parents. I don't remember him sleeping very well. He did not want to sleep in the crib. Mm-mm. So I slept on the floor with him, which is what you do in Korea anyway, right? For probably the first week or so.
The flight over from Korea was pretty exciting. I got new clothes for the flight. That was super exciting. I landed in Nashville, and I remember it was somewhat late at night, and my family was there to greet me. Four things I distinctly remember about that night. One, that was my first trip to McDonald's, so we stopped and got a Happy Meal, and I got this little Gonzo toy on a tricycle. Two, we had one of those old school Volkswagen vans at the time, and my parents had like folded down the back seat so my sister and I could like chill on our ride back. And they brought like coloring books and things like that for us to do. And I distinctly remember thinking how the crayons really like had a bad smell here in the States. Three, when we arrived to the house, we live in a very rural community, and our closest neighbor was like a mile, 2 miles away, so like really in the woods. And when we pulled up, the headlights of the van caught the eyes of the dogs that we had, you know, so you got that like red glowing in the dark eyes. So I was like freaking out about that. And then also like, you know, in Korea, they used to have those like house spirits like guarding the home, and I couldn't see the silhouette of those in the, on the roof. So I was really freaked out about the combination of the dog and the house spirits, like really freaked me out. And the fourth thing I would say is, I remember like building up this image of what it means to be a good American boy. And one of the things I knew that they had in America is everybody had their own rooms. I had never slept in my own room in my entire life, right? Like even growing up with my family, we would all share that same room together. But I knew like I had to be a good American boy and like be okay with sleeping in my own room. So that first night, my parents were fully prepared to like sleep in the room with me or have us all like sleep in the living room or whatever like that. But in my mind, I had it set like I will be a good American boy. So they took me to the room and I marched up the stairs and I got to bed and like pretended everything was okay. I felt the presence of my parents like watching over me just to make sure I was really okay. And then when I left, I just like started freaking out. Like I was so scared. I heard this noise and like, you know, much later on, like maybe like 2 weeks later, my parents took me to this Korean church. And so I was telling this minister, yeah, our house is haunted. Like there's all these noise and those house, like as a matter of fact, apparently. And it turns out it was like the air conditioner unit that was making all the noise or something. But yeah, a lot of memories from that first night of being adopted.
One of the things that I was confronted with in the orphanage is the idea of God. It's hard to escape that when the place is being run by priests and nuns. One day, the children, we were all gathered to go to be saved, be baptized. So we were all driven to this place, a big pool. There were Americans. And they would hold us in the pool, say some things, and then dunk us in the water, right? And then you're saved. So I remember like all of us like coming home and we were talking and I said, do you feel any different? And some of the kids were like, yeah, I feel great. You know, I feel like, And then a few of the other kids, I think, in my opinion, who were a little bit more honest, said, I don't feel anything different. I said, you know what, I don't either. I said, you know, maybe we have to do this again. The second time we went to the barber and we asked him, you know, so we told him, you know, we don't feel any different from this thing. You know, can you baptize us again or can you save us again? And so his thing was, I remember part of his shtick was, what are some of the bad things that you've said? What are some of the, like for instance, did you swear? Tell me what swear words you used. And actually I never swore, but I felt that I had to play this game. So I came out with words that I know the adults would use as swear words. And he wrote them on a piece of paper. Like everything that all of us said. Then he washed the piece of paper underwater. And then he threw it away. And he said, now you're cleansed. So I remember walking out of there going, God, I still don't feel any different. And I talked to a couple of the other guys, they're like, yeah, I don't feel different at all either. So we did it a third time. I mean, I guess I'm not saved. You know, I guess I'll burn. And that was a big fear of mine.
When I first found out that I was coming to the United States, you know, obviously, you know, I've never flew in an airplane before. And I was thinking about it, and I was like, well, how am I going to find these people, you know, when I come out of the airport or the plane? You know, because, you know, the joke is that, you know, all the Americans look alike. So I'm walking, and then the flight attendant looked at me, and then she was looking at my picture, and the flight attendant, you know, took me over there, and then somehow we were able to connect to this couple, which happened to be my parents. So my parents gave me the picture of me, and then I had a picture of them. And so I knew then I was at the, you know, the right people. And, you know, when I first saw them, I didn't know what to say or I don't know what to do, because it was something that, you know, I've been longing for so many years. Like that's all I've been thinking about was a family, you know, family, mom and dad, you know, house and everything else. And when it finally happened, I didn't know what to do. Like everything kind of shut me down. Like I didn't even give them a hug, even though I wanted to, because I wasn't sure if this was real or this is a real thing, or what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to act? Obviously, I didn't want to do anything silly, because I didn't want them to send me back. So I was like really, really kind of cautious at that point. Like I didn't want to say anything that was wrong. But I'll tell you what, I was so excited though. When I saw, you know, when I saw their faces for the first time, other than picture, you know, I feel like, you know, this is a chance for me to live again.
Well, at least two children. And we did it pretty quickly after Jack came home. We decided to begin the process again.
I was thrilled that we had a girl. I mean, we chose not to have a preference for gender for number two, but I was hoping for a girl.
Oh, well, she was the most beautiful child I've ever seen and have ever seen since. from day one, she was gorgeous, very intelligent. I could tell even at 6 months. The Korean foster mother said, no, this is your mother, and said this in Korean. And she looked right at me, and she was like an old soul from the second I met her. She blew my mind when she was about 5 years old, talking about memories when she was an infant. Remembering that, because it's very true, when she first came over, I kept the nursery very dark because I heard it was bad for infants' eyes. And I never talked to them about that with her. And she, when she was like 3 or 4, said, I was very scared when I first came over because it was very dark. She was right. She's a very smart child.
Well, I didn't know when I necessarily found out, but I've known for a while. But a lot of times kids, when my mom goes to gym or something and I have to go into like a daycare or something, there's new kids there who I haven't met before and they ask me, well, you don't look like, how are you related? And I tell them I'm adopted, and they kind of look at me funny and they say, oh, are you like Japanese? And a lot of people don't hear about Korea, so it's just kind of weird.
So finally I got to the United States, and we came down to New York, and then we took a New York flight to Pittsburgh, and then we drove to Pennsylvania, Greenville, Pennsylvania, a small town. But When I got in the car, and then mind you, I'd never, you know, been in the car before. And my parents had this fantastic 1968 Buick convertible. That was awesome. I go in there, I'm in the back seat, and I'm looking up, and you know, see the sky, and I said, this is a great country, this is a great thing. As soon as we pulled in, and I was like really, really thirsty because I didn't know how to say it, because I still can't speak, you know, obviously English, and my parents can't speak Korean. So, you know, we're doing a sign language thing, and then, you know, my mother goes in the kitchen, and, you know, I get this this dark water. So I'm looking at it because, you know, I was like, you know, I never had dark water before. You know, anything I had was, you know, back in Korea, obviously, it's water, you know, and every now we have this powder milk. So I think she realized that, you know, I've never had this, you know, thing before. So she actually took a sip first, and then I saw her, and she looked fine. So I said, okay, so I guess it's okay for me to drink it. So I took a sip, and I thought that was the worst thing that, you know, because I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, stuff's like bubbling in your mouth, and you have no idea what to do. So I just, you know, spit everything out, and my mother figured out something. So she just went to a faucet, and they got me just the water. And then, of course, you know, I drank that and I was fine. So to this day, you know, she always talk about that, you know, when I first had that taste of Coke, you know, the Coca-Cola. And the funny thing is now I love Coke. But when I first had it, never. So then late in the evening, and I had to use restroom, where most of our restroom, you have to go outside. And there's all you see is just like a rectangular hole. We didn't have toilet papers back in 68 and 69. You find that, you know, the biggest or the best looking like leaves. When I had to go to the bathroom in my house, I'm going outside and trying to look for this hole. Now mind you, my parents couldn't figure out what the heck's going on. But after a few minutes, my dad, I think, finally realized that you know, I had to go to the bathroom. So they take me upstairs and take to this room, and all I see is a bunch of white, you know, stuff all over. So I'm looking at this, and mind you, all the white stuff is like the, you know, the sink and the tub and the toilet and everything else. But none of that stuff we had before. It's like, okay, so you brought me up here, so what am I supposed to do now, you know, type of thing. So my dad, after a while, I think he just figured out, it's like, wait a second, he probably doesn't even know what these are. So my dad takes a cup, and put the water in the cup. So he pours it in the toilet. And then after he pours it, then he flushes it. And then I'm looking at this water, then water just like goes down, disappears. It was like a little boy seeing a ghost for the first time, because I was like no idea where the water went. So I kept watching it, and it's like, wait a second. And I said, wait, my mother's downstairs, so she's probably seen all this water coming down. So I'm running downstairs, And I'm looking around, and my mom was fine. Like, she's sitting there and she's not wet. And I'm like, wait a second, where did the water go? So I went right back upstairs, and then I saw my dad. And then, of course, the water all came back up again. So I kept looking at it, and then he did it again. So I saw the water went back down again, and then I saw water coming back up. So I was like really fascinated at this point. And then I kept flashing. I probably spent about 10 minutes just did nothing but flash in the toilet, because I was so fascinated with the water up and down, you know, and I'll disappear. And that was just the, you know, the greatest thing.
I don't think it took that much time for me to bond with my parents. I think in my mind, I had almost a stubborn attitude that these are my parents, this is my home, I'm a good American boy, right? Growing up, I would say that my sister and I fought like tooth and nails. Wait, that's not the right idiom. We fought like cats and dogs, but she's still my sister, right? Like, we might not get along every single day. We might fight over whether we're gonna watch, you know, Transformers or My Little Ponytails, but, you know, she's still my sister. I don't think it took that long to do that. I will also say, though, like, I'm not the type of guy that's like very effusive around my family, right? Like, in some ways I'm a really bad son, because like I don't go home that often, I don't call as often as I probably should. My mom always jokes that my sister, when my sister calls, she knows it's with good news, and when I call, she knows it's with bad news. So in some ways, maybe I don't have like the typical close-knit relationship with my parents and my sister, but at the end of the day, I love them and they love me, and I know that no matter what happens, like, you know, they're my parents.
I think Jack's was a more difficult bonding experience simply because he had been with his foster mother so much longer and clearly had a tight bond with her. Emily adapted really quickly. I don't remember any issues at all like we had with Jack.
And Emily was one of those babies that loved to be held. And I think that's maybe a boy-girl difference, but definitely the personalities. Emily, she would just like to be held all day long. The boys are more apt to like, whatever, dad, mom. They want to get down and crawl. So I remember with Emily, she was a lot more apt to just nurse and rock and, you know, just do that bonding.
I was adopted to a white American family, essentially, who had four kids of their own, and they had adopted five of us. So it was a pretty nutty family. I mean, just dealing with one kid who is your biological make is difficult. But when you have like that many kids with that much dysfunction, it's really a zoo times a million. And I was 9 years old when I came to the family. So I was fully formed. I have a history, I have a country, there's nothing that I'm done. There's no more bonding really to be had. I mean, that's the reality of it for me. So I remember that one of the difficult things switching into English was the letters L and R. And now I realize more and more as I learn languages and studying that Asian languages are short-tongued. All the sounds are very short.
The funny thing is, there's a show called MASH. MASH was the only show back then that had Korean folks on it, that actually spoke Korean, that actually did a lot of Korean things. So people ask me, like, how did you learn how to speak English? Like back in those days. I'll tell you, to this day, I thank MASH for, you know, my English at this point, because my parents didn't know how I was able to speak either.
When I first arrived, I didn't speak a word of English, except for apparently Mom and John. My parents were going to name me Park Lee Ripka because Park was my biological paternal family name, Lee was my biological maternal family name, and Ripka was my adoptive family name. So they thought that would be very symbolic. And so, you know, they tried it out, Park, Parker, Park. And I was like, John, John, John. So they're like, okay, apparently he wants to be called John. They elongated to Jonathan Lee Ripka because I think they thought John Lee sounded too much like Bruce Lee, you know, whatever. I might have made that up. Growing up in rural Tennessee, where you were the only Asian in a surrounding 50-mile radius, there was a lot of stereotyping, obviously. And I would say that I have the Dave Chappelle attitude towards how I coped with it, which was just, I was very self-deprecating about Asian stereotypes, and that's how I dealt with it. It took me a long time to get to that point, though. You know, in a very like positive, ignorant way, the community really took care of me. I could think of one example where like this family that was traveling through on the interstate had this accident and they were taken to the emergency room in a neighboring town, not even in my town, a neighboring town. And they happened to have young children and they happened to be Asian. So they called up my parents and like, hey, we have some Asian kids. You want to bring John by so they can like hang out? Now, they were Chinese, right? Like, I don't speak Chinese. Like, I have no idea. But I mean, in some ways, like the community really took care of me in that respect. But still, like, it was still a little different. And honestly, like, up through probably my mid-20s, every time I would see another Asian, I would just be like, that's another Asian. There's an Asian over there. Even when I went to college, I went to a small liberal arts college in Ohio, and there weren't that many Koreans at the school as well. One story I'm thinking about is my sophomore year. I was in the band, marching band, not surprisingly. And right before halftime, we all like line up against the fence before we like go on the field and do our little performance. And we were at an away game. And while we were there, there were these like three or four guys who were walking by, and they just started making fun of me, right? They were probably in their late teens, early 20s or whatever. And you know, they did the typical like Bruce Lee and like Kung Fu noise and all that stuff. And I felt like I couldn't do anything because, you know, whatever. But I grew up with a lot of that, and like I was okay with that. I think it was the fact that like I couldn't walk away because I had to like get ready for the performance. Like that really got under my skin, and I was just like fuming the entire time. So after halftime, I went to go find them in the stands, and like all my friends in the band, like they heard what happened. And so I had like this posse of band nerds like going for, you know, a fight. Like it reminded me like a scene from West Side Story. Like we're all walking up and we're snapping, right? And we find these guys, and I just like yelling at them, and they're like maybe like three or four rows down, and I just like yelling at them like, hey, no, I'm not a fighter. I mean, look at me, I'm not a fighter. I'm like, yeah, let's fight, let's do this, yeah, let's throw down. And they kept on ignoring me, the thing I probably should have done to them. And it just like pissed me off to no end that they were able to ignore me and I couldn't ignore them. And I just like started yelling more and more and more. And I just got so angry that I hyperventilated and passed out. So that's like, for me, like, if there's ever a moral to the story of me being able to walk away and just deal with it, like that clearly should have been the life lesson for me.
I remember one time a kid came up to me and said, he went like this, you know? Which like nowadays, I'm just like, you know, what's the big deal? But man, that hurt me so much. So he would incite two things. Either I would get into a fight with them, like in a physical fight, or I would cry, just break down and cry.
We've been very open about the fact that they were adopted and, you know, what it meant. Emily has certainly asked a lot more questions about why, you know, than Jack has, but we've always tried to educate them through books that we've been able to find, or just the experiences we've had through the adoptee groups about why it is that their birth mothers place them for adoption. And, you know, I think what we've tried to do is set that foundation for them in these early formative years so that when they become old enough and they want to explore on their own, that they're prepared to do that. I mean, we're going to give them all the tools they can.
I don't usually have an open dialogue with my parents about adoption. I'm okay with it. I just don't really discuss it with my parents a lot. But when I do, it's something that's kind of bothering me with it.
A lot of times I'll ask my parents about things, so I think I do kind of have an open dialogue about it with my parents. Because a lot of times I'll just go up to them and ask them all kinds of questions about it.
Well, we've been practicing with a Korean tutor for language, and I took Taekwondo, but I didn't do it for very long. And I like the Korean food. I've tried a couple dishes, and I really like it, so I think he'll enjoy it there.
I do like to learn more about our culture. I sometimes like find books about it, but there's not too many that I can find. And I definitely do like the food. My mom will sometimes, occasionally, make us something that's Korean.
Like, I have different facets of what I am that requires a relatedness. I need to know that other people are experiencing what I'm experiencing and that I'm not alone. And that maybe they can share some things with me that can help me. And then I can share some things with them. And it's that community that I've been resisting all my life. I just kept thinking that I could do it on my own. And it's been very difficult, you know? And almost impossible to do some things.
Well, what happened was, so I don't think my parents were ever officially married, and my birth father left. And so my birth mother went, I think she lived with her, what used to be my grandparents, so my grandfather didn't want me, my mother and my grandmother wanted me, but she couldn't keep me without the grandfather's approval, so just kind of upset to know that.
Emily's birth mother did send her a letter that I guess we got probably a year after we brought her home, and basically she said, listen, you know, I'm sorry that I couldn't raise you, but circumstances didn't allow it, and I knew although it was the hardest thing I've ever done, that the best thing for you was to place you for adoption. And she just said, oh, I wish for you basically a wonderful life, right?
I know that my mom wanted to keep me, but she just couldn't because she couldn't work and take care of me at the same time. I also know that I was born in Busan, and my Korean name is Ho Chul-suk.
I know that I was born in Changwon. I know my Korean name is Hai Choi-won.
For my father, I don't feel any anger that I'm aware of. I know that hurt can become anger, but you know, when I think about him, there's this one moment that stays in my mind, and that's, he would say to me, I will come back, I will come back. And then he would leave. And I would, one night, just come, or many nights, come to the edge of the porch and just look at the sky and just cry and wait for what feels like eternity for him to come back, because it just hurts. That hurt, I don't feel really has turned into anger. Perhaps it did, but I don't feel that. That hurt just stays hurting. And I prefer that.
Like back in 1970, probably 4, 5, I was still kind of feared because I didn't want them to send me back. And it's one of those things like, we have everything here where, you know, 90 days price guarantee, or you buy this and if you don't like it, you return and refund. And I'm thinking, it's like, if I did something wrong, are they going to send me back? You know, that was the only thing I think about for a couple years. I didn't want to talk about my life, my past life with my parents. I want to keep a lot of that secret to myself. And, I've always thought, is my brothers looking for me? Is my parents looking for me? Are they back together? Do they even know that I'm alive? So that thought process, that's been, with me for years, through my high school and in college.
I was wondering if I had like an older brother or a younger brother or sister of older, younger siblings, like before or after I was adopted. I also wonder who I looked like more and if they knew what I would look like if I went to go see them right now, like if they would recognize me.
I always kind of wonder about who I look like, and my mom's always telling me, oh, you look kind of like your mother, but I'm kind of questioning that a little because she's never really met her, so. Yeah, and I want to know if I have brothers or sisters after I was adopted, because I knew at the first time I was the first child, so.
I'm just curious about my questions. I don't want to like go too deep in it. I'm just curious like what it would be like if I did have brothers or sisters.
It's funny how people get bonded so quickly. And I feel as though at this point that my number one job was to make sure that my parents got to know who I was and that I did everything I can to make sure that they're not disappointed. So I was always trying to be the overachiever, when it comes to that part of it, because I really want to make them feel, proud of me, because of, what they've done for me. But, my parents they're just such a lovable people. You can't help, but to love them when you see them and when you meet them. So, yeah, I feel like, I brought a lot of joy, within my family. And then, of course, me, I still, that's all I worry about is just make sure they're happy.
Not all the hugs, trophies, because I used to take Taekwondo as well. And I used to go to tournaments and win a couple of trophies. Not all the job well done, you know, good grades in school when I did get them. It didn't lift the weight off my shoulders sufficiently. So when I got good grades, it was only because I knew that my parents would approve of me. You know, I was a pretty much law-abiding citizen in and out of the home, pretty much, because I knew that I would be loved. And the irony is, when I did those things and I got the love that I thought was gonna fix me, it didn't fix me. But that pattern, I couldn't break. So I lived in it for a long time.
Relationships, that's really tough. I have had the fortune of meeting a lot of nice women in my life. And I would like to think that all my relationships were positive and with just really caring and empathetic ladies, girls sound a little juvenile. Ladies, women, thank you, women. I will say though, I think this is a recent revelation. I think I'm a degree of like commitment phobe. And if I were to play amateur psychologist, I would probably suppose that part of that has to do with abandonment issues with my mother leaving. And I probably shouldn't say my mother leaving. Like, it's not like she actively chose to leave and say goodbye to her children, right? Like, she was in a marriage that was probably abusive, and she felt like probably safety of her life, she couldn't stay there, right? And then, like, all the whole patriarchal viewpoints on relationships in Korea, she probably didn't have the ability to keep me and my sister. So yeah, if I were to play amateur psychologist, I would say that there's probably a degree of that fear, and that before it gets to that point in my relationship, I probably start pushing away or don't allow myself to get fully there.
There was a big Korean adoptee supportive group. And then from there I went to the CON conferences, which are national conferences for adoptees and their parents. And I learned a lot of what it means for an adult adoptee. I mean, I can read it in a book, but it's also nice to hear them speak and hear them talk. And the very first CON conference I went to in Detroit, an adult adoptee said, my parents would always take us, you know, to the lakes every summer, and I would just wish one summer they would have taken us to Korea. They've spent enough money on vacations to Disney World, and I don't ever understood why I had to wait to my 30s to go to Korea. So that was very important to me, and I think it was, once I told Bill, it was important to him that we share the experience of Korea with them.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think I want them to go to a place where they look like everyone else, right? Where they don't feel different.
Right.
I want them to have that experience. Again, I think it's all part of building that foundation of self-identity and preparing them for later in life when, if they want to pursue it further, they can.
We're going to stay 5 days in Seoul and then 4 in Busan and then 1 more day in Seoul so we can catch the plane.
I'm really excited and looking forward to going to Lotte World, the big mall that there is. And just looking around and seeing kind of where I came from.
We're also gonna go see the adoption agency and the hospital where we were born, and I'm looking forward to all those. Well, I'm feeling nervous that we're not gonna be able to go see everything we wanted to, or like nervous about like the trip itself, like being a big city, like nervous that I might like lose my parents there by accident, like if we're in a big crowd.
I'm kind of nervous too because I'm scared that we won't be able to get around right or find where we're going.
It would be great if someday that both of them could meet their birth mothers, but we've just had no luck.
We don't know. And the Holt is telling us when we go that they have to be 18 to get that information. And now she's kind of mad at Holt because she is our little adult and she feels like she should be able to go there, march right into the South Korea and shake her birth mother's hand. And we have to tell her that no, we have to respect the law.
And their wishes.
Their wishes, right, which is you're not allowed to get that information until you're 18. So it's been a little bit more of a struggle for her than it has for Jack, I think. I think Jack wants to meet his birth mother, but he's never gotten a letter from her, so there's a little bit more of a disconnect there. Yeah.
So when I graduated from undergrad, I went to graduate school at Wake Forest, and that's when I started cleaning out my room in Tennessee. I like to joke that my mom turned my bedroom into a sewing room. That's not true, but I think like a real sign of adulthood is when all your childhood stuff is with you and not with your family. So I started that transition when I was in going to grad school, and a part of that was a lot of the paperwork, adoption paperwork that I had. So I inquired with my adoption agency and started a search for my biological family. And after about a year, year and a half, it didn't go anywhere. And then I started dating this girl in graduate school. She is Korean, but not adopted. And her parents graduated from Yonsei University, which if you're Korean, you know, is like the Harvard of Korea. And Korean culture, it's very hierarchical. So where you go to college is very, very important. And so because he went to Yonsei and graduated first of his class, he was connected to a circle of folks that were influential, powerful, and this guy happened to be the chief of police in Seoul. So after about a year and a half of fruitless search, I told Liz about it, and she's like, let me take this to my dad. And so I made copies of everything, and she sent it to her dad, and her dad sent it to his friend, and within a day, they were able to find my father. I didn't quite know how to, like, it was one of those things like, yeah, I'll start a search, and you know, if I get to it, I'll get to it type of thing. And then it finally got there, and so I didn't have a lot of reflection time before. And again, I had all this fear about, are my memories real or not real? Because growing up, I didn't have anyone to tell me, that's not true, that is true. So I wrote him a letter, and it was, I think, a very open letter to the possibility that all the what I thought were memories in my mind were not real. And he wrote a letter back about a week later that didn't deny or confirm some of the things that I had thought. And so we had a couple of letter exchanges, and in the middle of that, my sister wrote me a letter, like a 50-page letter in secret. And there was definitely desperation in the tone. There was a lot of curiosity, because the only thing she knew of her family was from my father. So she was too young to remember me. She was too young to ever remember our mother. And so I think there was this yearning for her to discover something other than my father as part of her identity. But her letter definitely corroborated a lot of the things that I had thought from my childhood.
I, about 8 years ago, thought to look at my father. The rules changed where they were able to release his name. So I got his name, and through people's search, like, I was looking for him. I wrote a letter, made couple hundred copies, put all the different addresses on it, and sent it out. One guy, he thinks he's my half-brother. Yeah, and he responded, and he says, and he told me details that correspond to my experience, and he says that if I am his half-brother, that our father's dead. So when he told me that, my interest to want to know him just dissipated. I didn't really want to know my half-brother or my father's side of the family. Like, without my father, for me, it didn't seem to make any sense. Emotionally, I was just hurt.
2009 is one of my saddest day of my life. We found out that my father, adoptive father, has cancer. And the doctor says, you know, he's got the, you know, pretty much stage four. Esophagus cancer at this point, and we were devastated. When he was in the hospital, taking those few last days of, you know, his life with us, he did tell me, you need to go back and do a search, because I think you need to know, you know, what happened to your biological family as well.
I got information about my Korean family. My uncle on my mother's side wrote me. He sent me a picture and wrote me. And he told me about my aunt who loved me. And so he says in the letter that she died of a broken heart. And as dramatic as it sounds, I can't believe it.
I was feeling really happy, excited that we made it there, and we made it there safely, and that we were just finally in Korea for the first time.
I was also happy and excited, but at the same time, tired, because since we traveled so much. But I was happy we were finally there. It felt nice being around Koreans, because we're Koreans and we're usually not walking near around many. But it was very crowded in Seoul. It's hard to get around if you were traveling on the sidewalk. But underground, it was easy travel.
It was really weird kind of for me just to have everyone look kind of like me, because I'm so used to look different by everyone else. So it was kind of weird looking like everyone else there.
I decided to go back to Korea to go for a visit. I told my father I would only be there for a week, but in reality I was there for 2 weeks. And I spent the entire 2 weeks with my sister, but kept it from my father. I think one of the biggest guilts of my life is the fact that I left my sister behind. I think this is very typical for a lot of survivors, that they feel a lot of guilt for surviving. And I think I've carried a lot of guilt about the fact that I got out and she couldn't. So the 2 weeks with her was just amazing. She's a very strong person. What's really neat is I was a teacher at the time, and growing up half a world away, she was in school to be a teacher as well. And then about halfway through the time, I went down to visit my father finally, and we said that my sister met me at the airport, and we just went straight down. He was at the time living in Gwangju, which is near where he grew up as well. And he was married to this woman, and they had a child together, Boram, who's like in high school now. Oh my God, she's in high school now. The first night that I was there, he made me, oh, I forget the name of the dish, but it's the hen, and it's stuffed with the rice and dates, and it's the soup with ginseng. Apparently this is very symbolic, like when a parent makes this for you, it's supposed to be just like every food in Korea, right? Like it's good for your blah or whatever that thing is. So apparently it was very symbolic that a father makes this for his son. And again, it was just so poignant, and it made me think about like, are my memories real or not real? He didn't speak English, I didn't speak Korean. So it was mostly a lot of guttural smiling and nodding. And my sister speaks a little bit of English, so she helped translate a little bit. And then this kid shows up. He was 19 at the time. And he's my half-brother from my father's second wife. My stepmother, my sister, and my half-sister had no idea that this kid existed. I remembered him because when I moved back to Seoul to after my grandfather passed away when I was 5, I remember another woman and a baby child. So I remembered him as a baby for a very short period of time when I moved back to Seoul. But my sister, my half-sister, my stepmother had no idea that this kid existed. And so when he showed up and everybody was like, who is this guy? Like, he's your brother. People were like, what the, you know, right? And the next day, we all slept together in the same room. It's like this weird cacophony of children from my father. But we all instantly bonded with each other. And the next day he woke up and he was like, I saw a ghost, like our father's evil and his spirit was like walking around last night, that kind of stuff. I'm making this sound way more superstitious than I should, and I'm probably making out my brother to sound ridiculous. I think the point of me sharing that is, I think the four of us are bonded together because of that. You can say what you want about my father and his probably unhealthy mental state, but the four of us instantly bonded because of that experience. I'm very fortunate to have and to know them in my life.
In the end, my dear, my friend, the thoughts of God and thoughts of men will all transcend.
I've had substance abuse issues throughout my life that I did to try to deal with whatever discord was inside of me. I had a relapse a few years ago that made me become aware that there is an underlying problem that I haven't really addressed. It was going to kill me, you know, if I didn't address it. And so when I was coming back from this relapse, I just had this idea to go online and just type in Korean adoptees and see if anything would come up. And somehow in my haze, I was connected to a Facebook page with other Korean adoptees. And then somehow in that process, I started to talk to a couple of them. And then it got more personal, and then they had a meeting, like a conference of sorts, you know, of all the adoptees, and about 80 of us showed up at DC, and that's when I first started hearing about people going back, and so I was encouraged at that meeting to find a way, and then the way came. A woman with a gigantic heart for Korean adoptees, put together a program whereby Korean adoptees can go back, and much of the finances would be taken care of. So it just made it really easy for me to say yes. So I was 47 years old when I finally went back to Korea. So that has been 38 years since I've been back. It's a long time.
When I went back to Korea the first time, I met one of my cousins. He's my hyung. He's like maybe 3 or 4 years older than me. And when we were doing a walking tour of Ansan, like we went to my school and I was like, oh my God, I remember this, like the look and everything, right?
This used to be my classroom in Ansan, Seoul Ansan Primary School. This is not what I remember. There's 4 buildings here. I don't remember 4. I remember there being 2 making an L-shaped formation. And one of the sides making a U were bleachers, and then this whole empty courtyard. And then one side didn't even have a building, it just had a gate. So I don't remember this.
And then he also took me to this building and he said, this is where your mom used to live. And that's what I remember as the house that I broke into of this lady. Now, I don't know why in my mind I think that that is not my mother, but my memory, I don't see her as my mother. But my cousin told me that's where she lived, and it looked in my mind exactly like the building that I broke into. So I have to think it is my mother. We weren't able to find her. My father's sisters, my father's the youngest, and he has 3 or maybe 4 older sisters. and they claim that they stay in touch with our mother. But my father's oldest sister said that she called our mother, and that our mother was too ashamed to meet me and my sister. And my sister and I kept on trying to relay through our aunt, like, it doesn't matter to us, like, we understand, like, you had difficult circumstances, and what was told to us by our aunt is that she was too ashamed. The idea of not seeing my mother again, I think I've come to terms with it. And it really came to head about 2-3 years ago. My sister sent me an email saying, "Father's sick. What should I do?" I feel like I couldn't tell her what to do because I'm the guy that at the end of the day can fly back across the Pacific and live a completely different life with a completely different family. She's the one that's in Korea, and she's the one that has to deal with it. I think she was looking for a big brother, and I think what I was doing was being very, very passive. And then, like, maybe like a month later, she's like, it's much worse than we thought. The doctors originally gave him several months, several years. Now we think he doesn't have a lot of time. You know, if you want to see him, you should come. So I booked a ticket that day to fly back maybe like a week and a half later. And he died 5 days after I booked my ticket. Never fully getting to explore with him, my father, my biological father, issues like forgiveness, redemption, closure, whatever that means. Losing out on that opportunity forces you to grieve without the other person. And I feel like when I think of my mother, I think about that in that same respect. It's a different circumstance. I don't think she's dead, but it forces me to think about that and bring closure to that and resolution with that without her involvement.
We're just excited to finally see a hole, and we walked down the street. We got into the office and we saw my foster mom and her friend, and our translator told us that later Jack's foster mom would be coming, but she was late, so it was really exciting to finally know that both of them would be coming. So it was just kind of fun to meet them. We talked a lot about what we were like when we were younger and what we do now.
They were kind of quiet at first, you know, they didn't really know what to do, and I think the translator just kind of helped with the conversation, and then they end up asking a lot of questions.
I was very excited because, like, I got to find out that I was the first one to come back out of 5 years of foster caring.
She told the story when they would go, told Jack the story that when they would go out on walks with Jack, that everyone thought that Jack was their child because he looked just like them. So, and then I think she's even said she had told her kids that she was going to meet Jack, and they were excited.
For me, I did get quite a few questions answered, like how many kids did she foster of kids, and she still works at
a hospital. Like, and she helps out
taking care of kids with special needs.
Emily's foster mom had a lot of children, maybe over 40. She had a lot of comments about Emily's dark skin and how she knew that she was Korean American and not Korean. Where Jack was born, I guess in Korea, they have certain attributes from, you know, where you were born. Strong, silent type was given to Jack because he was from the South.
When I saw my hospital, it was on a crowded streetway and there were a lot of kids. It was like mainly for children. I felt very excited and happy to see where I was born and see it was quite close to where we were staying when we were in Busan.
I was just, it was interesting. Like, I didn't know what to expect. I'm only used to Western hospitals, and Jack's hospital was a little run down. Mm-hmm. Surprised that there were so many people in Busan. Like, I had this fantasy in my head that somehow we'd bump into his birth mother, but you know, it's a huge town. It's just this, it just kept going and going and going.
So for me, we had to drive to my hospital in Tingwan, and it was exciting that I finally got to see where I came from. We were told it was very private, but it was very, very busy. That's just, though it had a lot of kids, but I was definitely excited to go and see where I was actually born. So I was not able to go and see my birth mom because now there's a law that you have to be 18 to do that, but I definitely want to do that when I'm old enough.
Family wants us to come back when she's 18, would love to go back. I mean, I think we'll see where she's at when she's 18, right? I mean, a lot of things can change, but I'm hopeful that she'll want to go back, and if she does, we'll support her in whatever way she wants.
We did learn through the social worker that Emily had an open adoption, and the birth mother was actively reading her file until she was 3, and then she stopped. So she said that's probably a sign that she's either married or she can't do it anymore, which was a little disappointing because we thought we were on the path to an open adoption with Emily, but it hasn't worked out that way. So it was a little, I think that was a little sad, but at least we had an answer to why she hasn't written us.
I might want to go like on another family vacation to Korea, or if we don't do that, like finish my studies in college and then probably go to try to find my birth mother.
I have a Korean a friend that lives with us in Canton, Ohio. Her family still lives in Korea, but she's been living in the United States for about 28 years. So she was telling me about a TV station in Korea that actually does a lot of this, you know, help finding the families and stuff. And I said, oh, okay. So after I got the website, I decided to write a, you know, just a short little email to, you know, the TV station, which is called KBS. Maybe a couple months later, I got this email across somebody back to them and saying that, hey, listen, you know, we're interested about your story. We just need a little bit more information. And then the last email, they say that the production crew really loves your story and we want to air your story live TV. And we just want to know if you, you know, be able to come to Korea in July such and such a date. And at this point, I got really excited. I was like, okay, this is my chance. You know, this is my chance of, you know, displaying who I am. This is my chance of putting out there. This is my chance of, you know, people in Korea to see the picture and maybe who knows, you know, where this can go. So I got very excited, and then we flew to KBS and, you know, did the show with, you know, the KBS film crew and everything else. But what was so incredible is that my brother, my oldest brother, actually was in the backstage, and he was back there waiting for me. And I guess he was crying because he was looking at the monitor, and he said that, you know, I mean, that's just no doubt, that's him. And while he was there doing that, they were able to contact my second brother, and he was still down in Busan. So he was taking a KTX, the speed train. So he was taking that speed train from Busan to Seoul station just so that he can meet us at the TV station as well. So everything was going on. I had no idea that was going on. What the commentator was saying that there's a surprise, and they said that I think they found one of your one of your brothers, which is oldest one. And my eyes just lit up at that point. It's like, oh, I mean, imagine seeing somebody after 43 years for the first time. And my heart was like thumping at this point. And I was so nervous, I didn't know what to say to him. What do you say to somebody else you haven't seen for 43 years? Well, as soon as he walked onto the stage, I looked at him, and I was just immediately, we were linked. Ah, wow, it was very emotional. We cried a lot. You know, when I was talking to the translator, you know, on the backstage with my brothers, because I asked them the same questions, like, what were my brothers doing when they found out that I was lost for all these years. And evidently, my brother was, as soon as he knew that he couldn't find me at the train station, he came back to the same train station for about 2-3 weeks just to see if I, you know, come back again. And when he found out that I was gone at that point, then he was looking at all these orphanages around it. My brother also asked the translator that why it took so long for me to find them. And I said, well, it's not something that, you know, it was that easy. I wasn't sure if the timing was right. I didn't know when it was the right time for me to start searching for them. I asked the translator, my brother, has he ever thought of like searching away from just to Korea to see if I was adopted at another country? Or, and then the translator came back to me saying that he did everything he could with different orphanages. And that's where I think he just given up the searching because he didn't know where else to go.
Yeah, so my first time back in Korea, I was there for like a week and a half. And, you know, I went with 20 or so other Korean adoptees to share this experience. And it was fantastic, you know, to be able to share it with people who have, who are also adoptees. And I found out that a very small percentage of people who go back to Korea have an opportunity to actually meet their biological family or some section of that extended family. And I got lucky, found my uncle. So one of the questions that arose was about my family and why is it that my uncle couldn't take care of me, my aunt who loved me so much couldn't take care of me. And you know, one of the reasons is just finance. You know, Korea was a devastated country. I mean, they could hardly eat. I mean, it was ranked like one of the top 5 poorest nations in the world, right? That's poor. I mean, we're poorer than Haiti. We're poor, dirt poor. And so the idea of sending kids off to adoption, are you kidding me? It's like, that's easy. No one has to think about that. That's not you ask the question and the answer comes out right away. Yes, send this kid away because he can eat, she can eat, and maybe we'll eat a little bit better too because we won't have another mouth to worry about, you know? And their hearts will be assuaged a little bit more. I think they made the logical choice, you know? Difficult for the heart, but that's what we do as grown-ups, right? Make decisions that's difficult for the heart, but that's the wise choice, you know, to make. So my uncle, who I didn't know super well, of course he couldn't take care of me, so. And he felt very guilty about that. He was very, very guilty. You know, and he just kept apologizing over and over again when I saw him. How sad he was that he couldn't do it, you know?
Say hi. Hi. 안녕하세요. 네, 안녕하세요.
손 흔들어 달라는데요.
안녕하세요.
안녕하세요. 안녕하세요. 해 달라는데요.
I met 2 of my cousins from my uncle's side. It was a boy and a girl, a man and woman, and the man was very distant and quiet and shy. Like I went to go hug him and he was just kind of like, he didn't know how to respond to that. You know, I know it's partly culture. I mean, I don't know if it's culture. I don't know, because I hugged my uncle. He didn't have any problems with it. I was hugging everybody else. They were cool with it. But he was just kind of like distant. So I thought it was kind of interesting. And then the woman cousin, she was very lively, very receptive, very excited to meet me. And we got to hang out. And one of the things that I realized about her personality is she's just a very similar personality to me. You know, we can be both very deep, you know, very deep in the way, but we can also be insanely goofy. I mean, I have this like really goofy part of me where I'm very playful and I only get into the deep things if I think that somebody wants to go there, you know? But essentially, I'm like actually very lighthearted, and so to see that in her as well, it's like maybe that's genetic. You know, I thought to myself, you know, maybe that's just something that we share in our family gene pool, you know? A couple of the jokesters, you know? And so that was great fun. And so, yes, we've linked up on Facebook. Thank God for Facebook. So, yes, I would love to see my uncle again. I would love to see my cousin again. And this time, just to have a little bit more time. You know, the thing about the tour is, you know, we're on an agenda. So we have to touch this, touch that, touch this, touch that. But this time I like to go and just like sit like this and just whittle away a day or two, you know? And maybe not even talk so much, just be near each other. That would be nice.
I found out that when I went back to Korea 2012, my father actually passed away in 2009. What's so ironic about that is my father from the United States passed away 3 months before my father from Korea passed away. My mother in Korea, she's been under coma for 6 years in hospital in Busan. Sad story to that is that my oldest brother kept her alive for 6 years in the hospital. And the reason why he kept her alive is because he made a promise to her before she went into coma, is that she's not going to be gone until they find out what happened to me. When I was at Korea reuniting with my brothers, we actually went to the hospital with the KBS TV station. So I went in the hospital and I actually got to spend time with my mom in the hospital now. So 2013, I decided to go back on my own. So I want to spend more time with my mom one-on-one. And I'm glad I did, because I think that was my final visit. Because now actually my oldest brother thought at that point that we can actually let her go. When I was reunited with my brothers, you know, was my life complete at that point? Absolutely. I think that was my last piece of the puzzle. Because that's something I really want to do, and that was the end of it. That was the missing link, and I can, you know, really, I can honestly say that I can say that was a closure to my life.
Have I changed since going back to Korea? It's bittersweet. It's bittersweet because it's not. It didn't fix me. It didn't, like, you know. I guess we go back for answers, for completion. That's ultimately the reason, I guess, why we all go back. But it wasn't really complete in that way. I think what I'm looking for doesn't exist anymore. What I'm looking for, I needed when I was 5 years old, you know? And, but I make the best of the situation that was given to me. And so I enjoyed their company, and just to hold them and to hug them and just to be there for them. It was nice. I am a little bit more clear about myself. I don't really feel Korean. And I feel actually more American than anything else. And I mean, in my behavior, in my ideologies, I think I'm very, very American. And one of the things about it is that it's actually made me appreciate America more. You know, there are many people who have sacrificed themselves for Korea to be the 12th richest country in the world. I mean, what a gigantic leap. And only what, like 40, 50 years? The fourth national gross product, per se, is that rebuilt Korea was sending out children for adoption. And there are many people who have sacrificed a lot. Not only have they sacrificed, but they've gained little to nothing. And their sacrifice isn't acknowledged. That kind of angers me a little bit. I gotta tell you, I have a lot of mixed feelings about being adopted. of course, based on the circumstances, it seems the logical thing to do. So, but how do I feel about it? Of course, I don't want that. I really do believe that my mother wouldn't have given me up. I really do believe that she would have done whatever she could to keep me. And I really don't think that's a delusion. I think she just loved me too much. And perhaps, despite all my difficulties, that is one of the things that keeps me alive.
Traveling is a lot of fun, and giving your children that experience. Meeting the foster parents was probably definitely the highlight. They have a Holt guest house in there, and I said, if you ever want to come back, you know, this is where you'll come, so they know specifically where it is. Just showing them their culture, and I just kept saying, if they want to come back, they can. Here it is. You know, all you need to do is take a plane ride. I feel that Jack soaked it in a lot. I feel like he got a lot out of it and was really excited. Emily, not so much. She was like nervous and talked a lot about her friends back home. And we were in the line at Lotte World. The boys had gone home because we were all exhausted. But she definitely wanted to do the monorail. So I said, I'll wait for you. We waited for like an hour and 15 minutes for this monorail ride. And I said, how does it feel? I'm the only white person in the line. And she goes, I like being different. And that's not the reaction I thought she would say. Like, I like being an American and I like standing out and being different. And I'm not here. But in a way, she really is a lot different, you know? Yes. She is. She's with a white mother, you know, and she can't speak the language, and she's darker than her. Right. So she is definitely a lot different.
I think the kids were very good travelers, and I think for them that's great to have that kind of ingrained in them now, so later in life they won't think twice about striking out on their own.
I was grateful because we were able to take this awesome vacation to another country that we were born in and we had never really seen since we were very little.
I was also very, very grateful that we were able to do that. Just an overall great experience, just being there. Because I kind of got some questions answered also by being around the place, like what was it like? That's often what I'd ask my mom. What's it like in Korea? How do people act, you know? And I finally got most of those questions answered.
So something in my heart opened up to the idea of reconnecting with my half-brother who contacted me. It's been about 10 years now ago. And, I just want to say, it's just so strange. I have these moments in my life when I feel like I wake up. Like something will happen, and I just go back to sleep for like 10 years. And then one day I wake up and I go, oh my God, that thing happened. You know, oh my God, my half brother was trying to contact me. It's moments like that, you know, I just like wake up and be like, oh my God, you know. And yes, I would like to get back in touch, you know, with my half brother and to meet him, you know. I don't really have any expectations about it, like what it means or anything. I just would like to do it because it's something that I have an opportunity to do that I haven't really done. And perhaps it may open up different things. Perhaps not, but at least I'll get complete with that idea. I feel like the more I travel and the more I experience the world, I just feel like I am just a citizen of the world. There's something deeper that unites us all. And maybe I think this way because I am adopted. Maybe I think this way because my mother died. Maybe I think this way because of all the things I've experienced, you know? And I'm starting to like it, so that's good. So maybe that's one of the things that going to Korea and getting more complete on this journey has helped me with.
I want to make sure that people understand, to me, adoption is, it's like second chance to live. I think it's the greatest gift that people can actually give to somebody. You know, we talk about gifts, 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 and gifts, 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 but I don't think there's a gift out there that can, you know, touch what adoption, you know, does for someone.
Adoption means, like, where your family loves you, but can't take care of you, and they are willing to give you up for a family who loves you the same amount.
You know, being a parent's the greatest thing ever. They allowed us to become parents. I mean, what more could you ask for? I mean, I don't know. I mean,
You can't top that.
Yeah.
I can't top that. That's
right.
An adoption for me, it basically means like she has a lot of courage to put her child there because she knows that her child will get a good family. And for me, it's kind of sad because she can't take care of me, although she wanted to, because she was a single mother and
the grandfather didn't approve of it.
I could have stayed in Korea if my birth grandfather accepted me, but he didn't, so.
I mean, adopted means someone wants you. That's true. But that's also one part of the story, one part of the truth. And the other part of the emotional truth to the mind of the child is that somebody doesn't want you. For me personally, I am grateful for my experience. I'm grateful that I've been brought to America. Because come on, man. I mean, there's a lot of things I can complain about America. We could talk about politics, whatever, blah, blah, blah. But there's a lot of great freedoms that I get to experience here.
I view adoption as the chance I wouldn't have had, right? Like, I am so blessed. At the same time, I know that a lot of other adoptees haven't had that experience. And honestly, I think I would be dead without adoption. So for me, adoption means, I think, life, right?